Back in Glasgow, Bob, Colin and Olaf will spend weeks testing every bit of new information against testimony from the official inquiry. Their knowledge of ship's design and engineering, their study of nautical charts, and their analysis of prevailing weather conditions and river currents at the time. Finally, their work is over, and the call to Dave is made.
We then come across the point that roughly here, the Empress had sighted a ship coming in on what was the Empress's starboard bow.
After months of poring over official testimony, after several expeditions up the St. Lawrence River, after risking the lives of close friends and of never being certain of what lay ahead, it has come down to this. Dave Greener must simply stand and listen, just as the officers of the Empress and the Storstad once stood in court to hear their fate.
The Empress has made an alteration, of course, to starboard. Suddenly both red and green side lights are visible from the Storstad.
What Dave hears comes as both a shock and a surprise.
That's what then the Storstad missed.
Well, I travelled, 6,000 miles for an answer, and I got one. It wasn't what I expected. I just want to take this home. I want to take this home and I want to share this. I mean, most importantly is that the word gets out.
Dave hadn't expected both ship's officers to be telling the truth about what happened. How could both Captain Kendall and First Officer Toftenes have told different stories and yet both have told the truth? As in life, timing is everything. Captain Kendall insisted he brought the Empress around to a starboard-to-starboard passing, unorthodox, but safe enough if both ships had stayed on course. On the Storstad, First Officer Toftenes claimed to have seen the Empress moving to a port-to-port passing. Two irreconcilable positions? Not quite. Under orders from Captain Kendall, the helmsman steering a ship the size of the Empress from one course to another would have first steered the ship well past her new heading. That's where timing comes in. From the bridge of the Storstad, Toftenes, seeing the Empress making her turn, had every reason to believe she was changing to a port-to-port passing, standard procedure for approaching ships. What Toftenes couldn't see because the fog intervened at just that precise moment was the Empress easing back after several minutes to the course Captain Kendall had intended all along, close to the Storstad and on her starboard side. Dead slow in the fog and fearing he might be drifting too close to shore and into the path of the Empress, Toftenes ordered the Storstad to pick up speed and turn to starboard in an effort to avoid trouble. Instead, Toftenes was steering the Storstad towards the very collision he had hoped to avoid. Clearly, the Storstad was not to blame for the collision. The fog was the real culprit. But why had Captain Kendall steered the Empress closer to the Storstad in the first place? Ignored at the inquiry, the reason is deadly simple. The Empress of Ireland had a schedule to keep, which meant steering the straightest possible line between Quebec and Liverpool. This made for fuel efficiency and the fastest time. Captain Kendall was simply making a routine course change when he ignored the risks and steered the Empress closer to the Storstad. His intention was to get his passengers to Liverpool on time, as advertised. That simple change of direction would ensure that 1,012 men, women, and children would never reach their destination. Although Captain Kendall was not solely responsible for what happened that night, his failure to act before and after the fatal collision condemned 1,000 men, women, and children to a horrific end. Throughout the inquiry, the Empress's captain took no responsibility for any of the deaths under his command, placing the blame instead solely on the Norwegian collier Storstad. Yet it was the forward motion of the Empress during the collision that opened the fatal gash below her waterline, and it was Captain Kendall and no other who ignored regulations and failed to order the watertight doors manned, then closed. The Empress went down in just 14 minutes. Every moment the watertight doors were closed would have meant lives saved. In his autobiography, Captain Kendall barely mentioned the Empress of Ireland, skipping over it as a memory too painful to mention. But the truth has a way of catching up to each of us sooner or later. Nurses attending him on his deathbed said that in his delirium, Kendall seemed to be reliving the horror of a shipwreck.
Tonight at 10, we head to the West Country as our journey through the Middle Ages continues. New to yesterday, we're in search of medieval Britain. Before that, our war zone continues with a tribute to the men who liberated Belsen. More heroes of World War II coming up next.
You know.